the painter's studio, a private place where the artist often works alone. Normally, the canvas rests on an easel and the colors are applied with brushes. After the painting is finished, little remains to show that it was made there. But the studio where Jackson Pollock and Lee Krasner painted is filled with evidence of both artists' work. Colors, gestures, marks as distinctive as handwriting. On the walls, the animated strokes Krasner used in paintings like Memory of Love and Gaia. On the floor, the remains of paintings that Pollock himself described as energy and motion made visible.
My painting is direct. I usually paint on the floor. I enjoy working on a large canvas. I feel more at home, more at ease in a big area. Having the canvas on the floor, I feel nearer, more a part of the painting. This way I can walk around it, work from all four sides, and be in the painting.
This was Pollock's studio from 1946 until his death in 1956. Although he had previously experimented with the spontaneous use of liquid paint, in 1947, he began to use pouring as his primary technique.
I like to use a dripping fluid paint.
His unusual working method and the remarkable abstract paintings he made with it were featured in a Life magazine article that brought him international renown.
Recently, a formidably highbrow New York critic hailed the brooding, puzzle-looking man shown above as a major artist of our time and a fine candidate to become the greatest American painter of the 20th century.
Many people, including the magazine's editors, found Pollock's imagery difficult to understand, so they concentrated on his technique. Life ran photographs that showed him at work in the studio.
Sometimes he dribbles the paint on with a brush, sometimes he scrawls it on with a stick, scoops it with a trowel, or even pours it on straight out of the can.
As far as Pollock was concerned, such issues were not important.
Doesn't make much difference how the paint is put on, as long as something's being said. Technique is just a means of arriving at a statement.
Still, people continued to be fascinated by his working method, which was improvisational and full of dynamic movement. Even his largest canvases were not big enough to contain his gestures, which spilled out onto the surrounding floor. If we look carefully, we can see where he worked on specific paintings. The direct relationship of the marks on the floor to Pollock's masterpieces of poured painting makes the studio a remarkable document of his most productive and innovative years, from 1947 to 1952. By 1952, when Blue Poles was painted, Pollock's work was selling well, and he had enough money to renovate the studio. Built at the turn of the 20th century as a storage barn, it was originally located behind the house. In June 1946, before it became his studio, Pollock had it moved so he and Krasner could enjoy the beautiful view across the salt marsh to Accabonic Creek. He had a wood floor installed and put a large window in the north wall to let in natural light. But there was no electricity or heat, so he could not work after dark or in freezing weather. Early in 1953, he hired local handymen to improve the studio. They installed insulation, fluorescent lights, a kerosene stove, and a tall door for loading paintings in and out of the storage room. Outside, the walls were shingled. Inside, they were covered with wallboard on which Pollock could tack his canvases. The floor was covered with tar paper and squares of pressed wood, and the whole interior was painted white. That summer, Pollock showed off his 24-hour year-round workspace to visiting neighbors. Paintings in progress can be seen lining the new walls, but invisibly, under the white floor, the wood surface preserves the record of his previous 6 years' work. At this time, Pollock was searching for artistic direction and often returned to more conventional painting techniques. And he was losing his battle with alcoholism, which reduced and finally destroyed his creativity. At the time of his death in an automobile accident in August 1956, there was little evidence of poured paint on the floor. Its relative blankness documented the action painter's loss of momentum. The year after Pollock died, Krasner began to paint in the Barnes studio. She and Pollock both worked spontaneously without preliminary sketches, but she preferred to tack her canvases and drawings on the walls. And like Pollock's, her energy often spilled over the edges of her compositions.
I would start and make some brush strokes across the entire canvas, and then pretty soon some image will suggest itself to me. And I start out from that, and then I keep moving with it.
After Krasner's death in 1984, the studio floor covering was removed to reveal Pollock's painting surface.
As you go towards the window, I have a feeling it's just going to get more and more brilliant and more heavy.
Today, under the aegis of the Stony Brook Foundation, the studio is open to the public as a monument to both artists' achievements. In this small room, only 21 feet square, Pollock and Krasner created the masterpieces of direct painting that brought American art to the forefront of international modernism. Those canvases are in major museums and private collections around the world, but the studio walls and floor vividly illustrate that their genesis was here.
I do have a general notion of what I'm about and what the results will be. I think it should be enjoyed just as music is enjoyed.